So
a long time, several times.
It's been a long time coming. So I'm very glad to finally be giving this. So to set the scene, while giving a presentation on my work some years ago, I was asked by a senior member of the department what it was that drew me to Elizabeth I of England. From context and tone, it was quite clear that this was a loaded question. Nevertheless, I ignored the heteronormative and gender normative accusations implicit in the question and replied that I felt great affinity and indeed sympathy for Elizabeth and the societal pressures she faced. I'm gay and non-binary, and as strange as it may seem, there are many parallels between me and a 16th century English monarch. We both come up against and are often in conflict with the strict gender roles that society places on what is proper for men and women. We both face down the inevitable and irritating question of marriage. The question so many gay couples are asked, which one of you is the woman, is eerily similar to the social dilemma Elizabeth faced. How does a woman who exercises supreme political and religious authority negotiate society's expectation that a woman submit to her husband? And finally, we both deal with the religious debates that still surface in politics and are used to exclude us from various aspects of society. Religion is still used today as an argument to exclude gay couples from a variety of legal rights, just as religion was used to exclude or discount Elizabeth's claim to the throne on the basis of her gender. While these three examples of the parallels are by no means an exhaustive list, they are different manifestations of the same underlying issue, that an inherent, unchangeable aspect of ourselves is being used against us to argue that we should be excluded, or at the very least made to accept, a separate but equal status. So, what does this mean for the historical Elizabeth? Elizabeth's contemporaries certainly engaged in a variety of strategies to conceptualize her rule and to do away with any perceived conflict between her position and her gender. Paradoxically, recentish cinematic and televisual depictions of Elizabeth seem to struggle much more with depicting Elizabeth as a successful female king than those living in early modern England. Indeed, thanks to a litany of depictions in popular culture, Elizabeth is widely believed to have struggled for the duration of her reign to be accepted as a female king, with her reign being some kind of aberration that was only successful because she had powerful men around her who kept her under control while steering the ship of state on her behalf. The following three examples from recent-ish film depictions are only the tip of the iceberg when it comes to the depiction of this struggle, but I feel that they are nicely representative. At the end of Shakespeare in Love, the audience, both contemporary and in the theatre in the film, are shocked to discover that Elizabeth has been in the audience watching the premiere of Romeo and Juliet. Elizabeth is asked to confirm whether the actor playing Juliet is a man or a woman, and Judy Dench's Elizabeth replies in a reductive and indeed anachronistic way, "I know something of a woman in a man's profession. Yes, by God, I do know about that." Apparently, according to Shakespeare in Love, Elizabeth may be a woman, but to survive in what can only be a man's role, she must hide away from and bury away her gender. In Shekhar Kapoor's Elizabeth, Elizabeth and William Cecil, Baron Burley, are having an argument. Burley tells Elizabeth that she needs to heed his counsel before finishing, "Forgive me, madam, but you are only a woman." Elizabeth is understandably indignant and responds fiercely, "I may be a woman, Sir William, but if I choose, I have the heart of a man." Knowing Elizabeth, if Burley had actually said that to Elizabeth, she would have slapped him hard. Finally, in Elizabeth the Golden Age, the Queen visits John Dee, the infamous English astrologer and alchemist, to seek advice from the stars concerning her deteriorating relationship with Spain, as well as the threat of Mary, Queen of Scots. This is how the interaction plays out. This is the quietest of the clips in the presentation, so I'm sorry about that.
Alignments of the planets is most unusual this year. Mars is due to take the ascendant 3 days after the anniversary of your majesty's birth. Also, on that day, there is a full moon, which governs the fortune of all princes of the female gender.
Princes of the female gender.
I mean to say, a prince who is also a
woman. Yes, Doctor, I am following you.
I'm always struck by the fact that Dee takes Elizabeth's ponderous statement as a question. Given Elizabeth's vast education, I think it's safe to assume that she knew what Dee was talking about, even if people in early modern England didn't distinguish between sex and gender like we do today. What these three examples all have in common is an emphasis on the conflict created by Elizabeth being a woman ruling as a king, and they all suggest that those around the last Tudor monarch had some kind of issue with Elizabeth's gender, which she constantly had to deal with. Unfortunately, such a view still pervades much of the scholarship on Elizabeth, whether this be on her, whether this be a focus on her unwedded and virginal status, or her general indecisiveness and constant desire to prevaricate on almost all political decisions. This is not to say that Elizabeth is not guilty of such criticisms. Indeed, she is probably the least decisive monarch to have ever sat on the English throne. With this talk, however, I argue that virtually none of this has to do with either Elizabeth's sex or gender, because contrary to the modern popular perception, being a female king was not an issue for the English polity or Commonwealth. In other words, Elizabeth's gender really didn't matter in 16th century England. Now, this argument draws on two key observations. The first is about the nature of monarchical rule in pre-modern Europe. From the evidence, it seems that sovereignty was essentially genderless. It's not a coincidence, I think, that the words sovereign and monarch are not gendered, and also that the title of prince can be and was used for both men and women. However, while sovereignty was virtually genderless, power was ultimately conceived of as being masculine. The best way to explain this distinction is the stupid practice of the wife of a king being styled the queen consort, but the husband of a queen is not a king consort. Now, whatever we may think of him, there is no rational reason that Prince Philip should not have been styled king consort in just the same way that his mother-in-law was queen consort, especially given that the queen mother continued to be called queen even after her husband died. It's fairly easy to see that there is an inherent conflict here. While sovereignty might be genderless, power was ultimately conceived of as male. However, I don't think it's an insurmountable conflict, and I think Elizabeth provides an unparalleled case study to unpack this conflict, especially if you view Elizabeth's reign through the lens of gender fluidity. In rereading and thinking about Elizabeth's conception of her own authority, and indeed her position as England's monarch, I've come to the conclusion that she often conceived of her own authority and position in ways that could be described as genderqueer or gender fluid. While these are obviously modern terms, what they describe, a person who does not subscribe to conventional gender distinctions, but identifies with neither, both, or a combination of male and female genders, or a person who remains flexible about their gender identity rather than committing to a single definition, and may fluctuate between differing gender expressions over their lifetime or express multiple aspects of various gender markers at the same time, are a clear and useful lens through which to view Elizabeth's gender and the performance of said gender. Throughout her reign, and sometimes in extremely important and public pronouncements, Elizabeth described herself in ways that demonstrate gender queerness or gender fluidity. Famously, when addressing her troops at Tilbury in August 1588, she declared, "I know I have the body, but of a weak and feeble woman, but I have the heart and stomach of a king, and of a king of England too." Such a genderqueer pronouncement, however, is not unique. In a speech to Parliament delivered in November 1586, and in response to a petition urging that Mary, Queen of Scots, be executed, she claimed to have sought to learn what things were most fit for a king to have. And most significantly, in what would be her last speech to MPs, and which is now known as the Golden Speech, Elizabeth referred to herself as a queen, a prince, claiming that there is no prince that loveth his subjects better or whose love can countervail our love, and a king, referencing her kingly dignity, her kingly bounties, before declaring, "To be a king and wear a crown is a thing more glorious to them that see it than it is pleasant to them that bear it. For myself, I was never so much enticed with the glorious name of a king or royal authority of a queen. In these examples, and in many others that I don't have time to discuss here, Elizabeth openly blurred the line between both gender and sex, assuming both male and female roles. Scholars have commented on Elizabeth's genderqueerness in varying ways, even if they haven't used the term. In the 1980s, Christopher Haig described the last Tudor monarch as a political hermaphrodite. Lisa Hopkins has described that the queen who could be a king when she wanted to be also knew that sometimes it may pay to be a lady. And Mary Beth Rose, whose work has had a profound impact on my own thinking, has discussed the way that Elizabeth used gender as a weapon, but only when it suited her, preferring sometimes to completely ignore gender problems. As Rose has cogently demonstrated, Elizabeth created her monarchical persona by monopolizing all gender positions, taking rhetorical advantage of the special prestige of both female and male subject positions, as these were understood in the Renaissance, without consistently privileging either. These studies and many others all emphasize the way that Elizabeth's gender and the way it was viewed and interpreted changed depending on the relevant context and the outcome Elizabeth wanted or was perceived to want. Such views of and about Elizabeth's gender are only possible, however, if contemporaries allowed her to express her gender in such fluid and sometimes contradictory ways. Despite the advent of feminism and the publication of many excellent revisionist, gender-conscious histories of Elizabeth, female kingship in the pre-modern period is still considered an aberration, a virtually insurmountable problem that had to be regularly confronted. Instead, it is clear that Elizabeth did not experience the undue hardship, overt sexism, or anti-female polemic that some scholars and the general public alike believe that she did. While critics of female kingship did exist, they were in the minority. Their existence has only been amplified because of the publication of a few infamous rants that are frustratingly and disproportionately overrepresented in scholarship. John Knox's The First Blast of the Trumpet being the most relevant and obvious example. In fact, when commentators attempted to grapple with Elizabeth's gender, they were more likely to think of Elizabeth in both masculine and feminine ways. For instance, in Parliament in 1559, Nicholas Heath, the Archbishop of York, described Elizabeth as our sovereign lord and lady, our king and queen, our emperor and empress. An anonymous writer in 1564 described Elizabeth as my most dread and most gracious sovereign lord and lady, to whom under God I owe all obedience. And around this time, the Scottish ambassador described Elizabeth, admittedly because she was unmarried, as king and queen both. As an aside, my main area of research is biblical typology, which is the habit of using figures from the biblical past in claiming that they have a contemporary relevance. For instance, Henry VIII was frequently compared to King David because both men had defeated more powerful foes, David the giant Goliath and Henry the Pope. Elizabeth was regularly compared with a range of biblical figures too, most especially the Deborah the judge. However, she was also compared with male biblical figures. Her preservation under Mary I's reign was compared with God's protection of Daniel in the lion's den, and she was often compared to King Solomon. For instance, in 1565, when Princess Cecilia of Sweden came to visit Elizabeth, numerous writers depicted Cecilia as the Queen of Sheba coming to visit the English Solomon. As William Camden summed up in his Annales, as the Queen of Sheba came to see Solomon, so the rare virtues of Queen Elizabeth brought Cecilia from the furthest part of the north to see so complete a majesty. No other early modern monarch, either male or female, was so frequently compared with both men and women from the Bible. If we think of Elizabeth's gender fluidity manifesting through the expression of multiple aspects of various gender markers at the same time, it is perhaps unsurprising that Elizabeth was described in such gender terms, terms that Elizabeth herself would use. Queering Elizabeth's gender requires interactions with other people, for the most part. Unlike her subjects, Elizabeth could have got away with wearing almost whatever she wanted. And while she didn't turn up to Tilbury wearing a full suit of armour, she probably did wear some kind of breastplate or armored bodice. Nevertheless, it is worth pointing out that rallying your troops before an invasion is not a regular occurrence, and if Elizabeth did contravene gendered stereotypes there, it was probably thought of as being part of her response to the crisis. For the rest of my paper, I want to theorize Elizabeth's gender fluidity by analyzing several of its various manifestations in film and TV. In the 2018 film, Mary, Queen of Scots, Josie Rourke made clear her intention to offer a feminist retelling of the intertwined lives and reigns of Elizabeth and her cousin Mary. Various scenes in the film have been noted for their commentary on Elizabeth and her gender, but there's one in particular that emphasizes the conflict between the position Elizabeth held and the societal expectations placed upon her gender.
You have neither husband nor children. And you approach an age whereupon you cannot bear them. You must confront the truth, madam, displeasing as it may be. I have confronted this truth.
You understand that I cannot.
Will not. Do I understand? No more than I understand God.
It is my choice. God would have a woman be a wife and a mother.
So you defy his will?
No. I choose to be a man. And marriage is dangerous. Such a man as I might marry, finding himself disappointed.
You would conspire.
No prince's revenues be so great that they satisfy the insatiable ambition of men.
This I understand.
It is why you are the closest thing I shall ever have to a wife.
I shan't mention your proposal to Lord Dudley. This world is a brutal place. We men must be wiser, mustn't we?
The we men line is very telling, as is Elizabeth's declaration that she's choosing to be a man. I also think that describing Cecil as Elizabeth's wife is actually a useful way of conceiving their relationship. Cecil may have controlled the day-to-day governance of England, but he was very much subservient to Elizabeth, which replicated the early modern expectations around marriage and spousal roles. Obviously, the real Cecil would have been offended at the idea that he was being thought of as a woman. But if Elizabeth is married to England, as she claimed to be on multiple occasions, is she England's husband or wife? As I alluded to at the start, one of the issues that we face in theorizing Elizabeth's gendered expression is the pervasive Aristotelian view of the gender hierarchy in the pre-modern period. This view held that being a man was inherently superior to being a woman, which in turn meant that to call Elizabeth manly was a compliment, but to describe a king as womanly was a sharp criticism. So, Walter Raleigh's claim that King Elizabeth was succeeded by Queen James contains a number of rebukes and comments. The slippage in this patriarchal view is partly why I think conceiving of Elizabeth as gender fluid can be a really useful tool. There was certainly flexibility around the edges of this binary, especially when class was involved, but calling Elizabeth an emperor or a king goes well beyond this. You don't need to call Elizabeth a king to suggest that she's overcoming the frailties of her sex. One way that Elizabeth truly upset the heteronormative apple cart was by dying single. One of the most well-known facts about Elizabeth is that she never married, and I'm sure that most of you here today have heard Elizabeth be described as the Virgin Queen. I hate this moniker so much, mainly because Elizabeth wasn't the only English monarch to never marry, and therefore theoretically die a virgin. For instance, Elizabeth's own half-brother, Edward VI, was unmarried when he died at age 15 and three quarters. While his age perhaps excuses him, his almost contemporary as King of France, Francis II, married at 14, and Edward's uncle, the ill-fated Arthur, Prince of Wales, was betrothed to Catherine of Aragon at 11, and the couple were married 2 months after Arthur turned 15. In addition, William the Conqueror's son, William II, was unmarried when he died at age 44. While chroniclers claimed after his death that he had been a sodomite, he seems to have shown no interest in sex with either men or women, so he may actually have been asexual. And finally, Æthelstan, who reigned in the early 10th century, was the first person to be described as King of the English, and who died at 45, was remembered as the Virgin King, and he was celebrated as such in at least three different plays in 16th and 17th century England. I suspect, however, that misogyny plays a huge part in this. It's apparently more acceptable for a man to remain single, even though the fact that both William II and Æthelstan dying without children caused just as many problems, if not more, than Elizabeth's childlessness. While Elizabeth certainly enjoyed dangling the prospect of marriage like a solid gold carrot, it is pretty clear that Elizabeth would have married if a consensus could have been reached on whom she should marry. That was the biggest sticking point. Every suitor came with various red lines and baggage, and none of her supporters and counselors could agree on who she should marry. I love this short interaction in Elizabeth. While the Queen would never have said anything like this, it accurately sums up her predicament.
Your Majesty would improve all these matters if you would agree to marry.
Marry who, Your Grace? Will you give me some suggestion? For some say France, and others Spain, and some cannot abide foreigners at all. So I'm not sure how best to please you unless I married one of each.
Now Your Majesty does make fun of the sanctity of marriage.
I do not think you should lecture me on that, my lord, since you yourself have been twice divorced, and are now upon your third wife.
I love that scene so much. It's so great. There is a big difference, I think, between the Elizabeth who decided that she would never marry and the Elizabeth who was never able to marry because her choice of spouse was too controversial. As I mentioned at the start, the differences between these two Elizabeths says a lot about how a gender is conceived. And if we think of Elizabeth as being genderqueer, we are able to understand more fully the way that society's expectations pushed Elizabeth into a corner, which meant that she wasn't able to express herself in a way that was authentic to her feelings and preferences. Building on this scene I've just shown you, I want to turn now to one of the sketches from the short-lived TV show Beehive. The sketch really plays with how weird this moniker of Virgin Queen is, and in doing so, it invites us to really question our obsession with Elizabeth's supposed lack of sexual intercourse. Now, just as a little content warning, this scene is a little bit crass, so you've been warned.
The Spanish Armada has a fleet stationed in the English Channel. 3,000 men await orders at Tilbury. But we have no chance if the fleet in the English Channel joins with the Armada that has set sail from Spain.
What is that?
It's the Spanish Armada.
What are you thinking?
Well, Your Majesty sent me a note half an hour ago asking for a brass miniature of the Spanish Armada. This proved difficult to procure.
Just once, I would like you to do the job that I've asked you to do. Fuck!
Of course, I'm terribly sorry, Your Virgin Majesty.
What? What did you just call me?
Your Virgin Majesty.
Shut up! Why would you say that?
Because that's Your Majesty's name.
No, it's not. Who else is calling me that?
The entire country, Your Majesty.
What? That's dumb. Because I'm not. I've done it loads of times.
With whom? Your Majesty?
This guy I met on holidays. What was his name? Albert.
What was his last name?
Who's?
Albert's.
Chicken Wing.
Your Majesty slept with someone called Albert Chicken Wing.
Yes, Your Majesty slept with someone called Albert Chicken Wing. If the two fleets of the Spanish Armada join forces, our men at Tilbury would be overwhelmed within hours. Your Majesty, Sir Albert Chicken Wing is here to see you. Oh, is he?
Oh, really, is he?
Well, I might go and see him now, seeing as he totally exists. And I gave him a hand job last summer. Slut. Oh, yes, but she's right good at blueies.
I think the thing I love most about that scene is Sarah Kendall, who's a fellow Antipodean. Her Australian accent comes out very strongly when she's being angry and indignant, and it makes me so happy. So there's a lot going on in this scene, but I think it shows nicely how ideas about gender can be foisted onto people whether they want them or not. Now, scholars generally date the emergence of the Virgin Queen iconography to Elizabeth's 1578 progress to Norwich. This means that by the time of the Armada invasion a decade later, the concept was well and truly established, meaning there is no way that Elizabeth would be unaware that people were calling her the Virgin Queen. As I will get to in a bit, the genetic was just as much a social construct as it was a biological reality, if you can call it that. Generally speaking, in the pre-modern period, one was a virgin as long as one's hymen was intact. This meant that even if Elizabeth had given hundreds of blowjobs and handjobs across her life, she was still a virgin, as she did not have penetrative vaginal sex. I also love in that scene how Elizabeth's advisor, who is probably meant to be Sir Francis Walsingham, goes quickly from extolling Elizabeth's virginity to calling her a slut. This fixation on the hymen was actually something Elizabeth herself was quite concerned with. Elizabeth ordered that when she died, there was to be no kind of autopsy or post-mortem carried out, especially on her vagina. Despite all the rhetoric about Elizabeth being a virgin, we actually don't know if this was the case. I think it highly unlikely that Elizabeth ever had sex after she became queen, but given that she succeeded to the throne at 25, it is very possible that she participated in any number of sexual activities in the decade or so before them. It's also worth noting that as a keen hunter and horse rider, it is almost certain that Elizabeth's hymen would have been broken by the time of her death. Which brings me to my point. Why do we remember Elizabeth because she never married and apparently never had sex? It's just bizarre and doesn't happen to the unmarried male English monarchs. One scene that I really think plays this up is in the Golden Age, in which Elizabeth is able to clap back at this obsession with her lack of sexual intercourse. A variety of potential suitors are being introduced to her. Interestingly, these were all real suitors of Elizabeth's at some point, although the timelines are off. For instance, they use a real portrait of Eric XVI on the screen here, which was possibly painted for Elizabeth, but he was well and truly deposed and dead by the time this scene takes place. Likewise, the Archduke of Austria has been aged down about 20 years. In reality, he was only about 7 years younger than Elizabeth.
King Eric of Sweden, Majesty.
What I care for, still madly loves him. Still mad to me.
Ivan, thank you. Tsar of all the Russias.
Where's theirs?
Known as Ivan the Terrible, Majesty.
Legs.
I beg your Majesty's forgiveness.
Given. Once.
The Archduke Charles of Austria, Majesty.
The puddle man is my sir, Majesty.
My suitors.
Younger brother to Maximilian II, Holy Roman Emperor.
Cousin Philip of Spain. Wealthy.
He's rather handsome.
How old is he?
Young, I believe, Majesty. An Austrian alliance would keep France quiet.
And Philip, leave. I think I'm almost enthusiastic.
Send to him.
Thank you, sir.
How much longer do you think I can play this game, Francis?
Virginity is an asset that holds its value.
Walter Raleigh, Majesty.
Your Majesty, this man is a notorious pirate. Spanish gold stolen from Spanish ships attacked without provocation.
Well, sir, what do you want?
I have just returned from a new world, Majesty. I have claimed the fertile coast in your name and have called it Virginia, in honor of our Virgin Queen.
Virginia? And when I marry, will you change the name to Conjugia?
It's certainly funny to think about. Seven American states are named after English monarchs or people who would become an English monarch. So, well, George II got Georgia, Charles I got the Carolinas, and Queen Henrietta Maria, who was known as Queen Mary in England, got Maryland. Elizabeth is commemorated by Virginia. In what other context is the fact that someone has never had sex commemorated in such a way? As Walsingham said in the clip, virginity is an asset that holds its value well. It's thus much more than merely a biological fact and is just as much a political construct. This emphasis on Elizabeth's virginity, I think, is a huge part of the reason we perpetuate the idea that she had to constantly struggle to be accepted as England's sovereign. As Monique Whiting has argued, the category of sex is the political category that found society as heterosexual. In failing to participate in the most important of heterosexual rights, marriage and giving birth to children, Elizabeth causes tension that cannot be resolved. By not marrying and not having children, she is automatically placed outside of society structure, even though as queen, she is at its center, or indeed its apex. If you return to the Tilbury speech, which I mentioned at the beginning of this talk, writers and directors seem to have little issue with Elizabeth declaring that she has the body of a weak and feeble woman, but they seem to stumble on her follow-up declaration that she has the heart and stomach of a king. While I have sought to queer Elizabeth's gender and bring more nuance to its representation, it is important to remember that Elizabeth is a product of, and indeed probably believed in, the heteronormative and patriarchal social hierarchy in place during her life. I really like this scene in Upstart Crow, in which Shakespeare and Marlowe discuss Elizabeth's reaction to the notoriously misogynistic Taming of the Shrew. I actually think this exchange is more or less spot on. Elizabeth was not some proto-feminist or even a proponent of gender equality, but I think her existence, her experience, does show that the gender binary that people insist on upholding even today is completely arbitrary, and that the expression of gender was much more fluid in the past and suits the arguments of bigots today. We will never know whether Elizabeth truly was a virgin or what she thought about her gender identity, but if we stop trying to place her in some arbitrary box and look at the evidence of how she and those around her conceived of her gender, we can uncover a much richer and more nuanced understanding of the ways that gender and sovereignty interacted in the pre-modern world. Thank you.
Thank you. Can stop recording now, if that's okay.